Before I get even further, I'll tell you a little bit about how I became interested in star clusters. More so open than globular, but both of them. My first astronomical equipment, both components were more suited for wide field viewing. I had my brother gave me a pair of Fujinon 10x70 binoculars, and if you've never looked through some, they're wonderful binoculars. They're extremely clear, and you bring in a whole lot of light, and you have a very nice, wonderful wide view. My first telescope after I re-entered amateur astronomy was a Teleview Pronto Ridgefield telescope. So that's a 70mm telescope. It's not an apochromatic, but it's a nice entry-level telescope, and it gave me a little bit more variety for the power I was able to use for observing. So I had the binoculars for nice wider views, and the Pronto for wider views and even a little bit more concentrated views. So rewind history even a little bit further. After I became interested, I started researching open star clusters. So I went to the internet. This was back about 20 years ago, so this was in the late 90s. And I noticed that one of the groupings of clusters that was mentioned a lot was what are called colander objects. Okay? So I looked a little bit more on, you know, what in the heck are these colanders? They're all just open clusters. And they are open clusters that were cataloged by a gentleman named P.R. Colander. And he was working on his dissertation at the Lund University in Sweden. And what I did was I looked up Lund University in Sweden, and I sent them an email. I sent the main admin office of the astronomy department an email. And I said, hey, I'm an amateur astronomer. I'm doing an amateur astronomy project on open star clusters. Would you happen to have a Xeroxed copy of Per Colander's, you know, dissertation and his work, right? So, to my amazement, 3 days later, in a Swedish express mail envelope, big envelope, came a never used, never read copy of Per Colander's dissertation from the 1930s. Okay, so you'll ask, how did you know it wasn't red, Ed? Because I had to use a X-Acto knife to cut the pages, because when it was printed, it was folded, and the folds were still along the edges, okay? So I was thinking, hey, this is going to be great. So I started looking through here, and it's like, oh, hey, I took calculus in college, and oh my God, there's, you know, wait a minute, there's integrals, and there's sigmas, and there's just, you know, clustering of, you know, statistical stuff. This is not light reading. But it is a wonderful, this is one of my prized possessions in my astronomical library. It has some of the plates that he used to look at for his dissertation, because he used a variety of plates to look at the actual stars he was determining to be in clusters. And it's just, you know, since then it's been a fun passion of mine, our star clusters. So that's sort of the history behind why, and of course, and back here it is, you know, 1931. So that was almost 100 years ago is when he did his dissertation. And still today, these 400 and some odd star clusters are still observed by amateurs and still observed by many. And there's a little bit of a story about one of the clusters that he has in here as being cataloged as an open cluster. And we'll get to that in a few minutes here. So we have the two different types, open and globular. So we will jump into open. So what is an open cluster? An open cluster is, and this is when we're getting into a little bit of the scientific bit here, it's physically related group of stars held together by the mutual gravitational attraction of the stars.
Okay?
It's nothing more than a dispersed grouping of stars that are held together by their mutual gravitational forces. Okay? So, how are they classified? There are a few different astronomers that have more of a detailed open cluster classification system. There's the Shapley scheme. It's relatively simple. It addresses the concentration and the richness of the open cluster. And then there's the R.J. Trumpler scheme. It's much more sophisticated and detailed, and it adds the brightness to the scheme. Okay? We'll kind of go through a little bit of, Shapley scheme is pretty simple. A through, A, D, E, G, F, and G. Very loose and irregular. I've known a few people like that. Loose and poor, intermediately rich, fairly rich, and then considerably rich and concentrated. Concentration, of course, you have detached, strong concentration towards the center, a detached, weak concentration towards the center, or a detached, no concentration towards the center. So you have a little bit of more detail going on in the Trumpler scheme. And also, the Trumpler scheme throws in a brightness. How bright is that open cluster? So we'll take a little look at a few here. Of course, the richness has its own little, subclassification. Poor is less than 50 stars up. I don't want to go that far yet. So poor is roughly less than 50 stars. Moderately rich is 100 stars. And very rich is more than 100 stars. So one of the things you'll ask is, how open are these clusters? This is the Big Dipper. And the stars in the Big Dipper are actually part of an open cluster. And a little bit more, our sun is a member star of this open cluster. So research has shown that we are part of this star cluster that's floating around. One of the reasons they've determined that is that the shape of the Great Big Dipper is not the same. You throw it ahead in time, or you throw it way back in time, it's a completely different shape. The stars are actually moving. They're moving in different directions. So these stars are not a pinpoint way out there that they're not moving around. They're moving around our sun, and our sun is moving around them. Okay? They can be very compact. They can be compact, like Messier 67 in Cancer. It's a very nice open cluster. It has a somewhat of an irregular shape. It's not a perfect circular shape like we'll see in a little while about globulars. This is readily visible from your backyard in urban settings. One of the things also about star clusters, both open and globular, is the aesthetic of them. They're very aesthetically pleasing to the eye. I find them very aesthetically pleasing. That's one of the reasons I enjoy looking at them. Many nights in the past, during the winter, I would set up my telescope and spend the whole night looking at one open cluster. One of my favorites is, see if we have it next, M45, the Pleiades. I've spent hours looking at it, putting in different eyepieces, going to different magnifications, going wide, going narrow, going in the middle. It's a wonderful, beautiful object to take a look at. M35 in Gemini is also a wonderful, wonderful star, open cluster. It's one of the open clusters where as you increase in magnification, you bring out more of the stars that are in the cluster. So it's kind of like you look at it with a wide view, and it's beautiful. You crank it, you double up your power, you narrow in your field, you bring in more of the stars that are in the cluster. It's like you're grabbing more and more and more. It's a wonderful object. And NGC 2158, which is right next to it, is also an open cluster, but it's very small. And one of my memorable moments observing M35 and NGC 2158 was about almost 20 years ago. It's back probably about 1999, 2000 time frame. One of our observing sites that we used to have was a park out by Middleburg called Mickey Gordon. There's a story about why we no longer observe there, but that's a different story. And is Pete here tonight? Pete Johnson? Okay, Pete Johnson, one of our members, one of our board members, former president, former vice president, etc., he has a 24-inch Dobsonian telescope. He calls it his giant optical device, his god. Well, he had it set up out at Mickey Gordon once, and he said, hey, Ed, come over here and take a look. So I looked and I thought, oh, wow, that's pretty cool. I'm looking at M35, and that's really great. No, I was looking at NGC 2158 because it's as wonderful as its neighboring open cluster, but you really need more aperture in order to zoom in and actually appreciate its beauty along with M35s. There are three that are in Auriga, M36, 37, and 38. They're wonderful. They're almost like in a line. They're a little more open than some of the other ones. M41 in Canis Major is right down below the bright star Sirius. It's a wonderful one. M44, the Beehive in Cancer, is wonderful. That's one of the ones where you look at it, you crank up the power, and more just comes at you. It's a very concentrated open cluster. And of course, a fun one just to point out in the sky when you're with your friends, family, whomever, is Colander 70. Orion, the stars in Orion's belt are an open cluster. So the three main stars and some of the neighboring stars are actually part of an open cluster. There we go, M45, the Pleiades, an absolutely wonderful object to take a look at and enjoy. It's readily visible even in our suburban environments. You get out further out west where it's darker, it's a phenomenally beautiful object. Here's M35, right in this area right here, and here's NGC 2158. So when Pete had his giant optical device out, we were zoomed in on this, and it looked like this. It was phenomenal. It was a wonderful view. 37, 36, and 38. So we have 37 down here. We have 36 right here, and then 38 up here. So it's a wonderful, and it's also a very rich field of stars because it's almost in our galactic plane. It's along the galactic plane. So you have lots of other objects to observe there. M41, here's Sirius, here's M41. Another wonderful, beautiful object. 44, the Beehive. 'd always throw this one in as a bonus. You have M46 and 47 in Pupis. Okay? Right here and right here. And right here, you have a planetary nebula that's a bonus in one of them. So as you crank up your power, you get to see the planetary nebula that is surrounding one of the stars that's within that open cluster. So it's I call it a bonus object. Of course, Calendar 70, the belt region. Now also, the head of Orion, three stars, and there's actually a few other fainter stars that are in his head, but would be his head, are also an open cluster. So they're all over the place. Colander cataloged 407 of them, I think 471. So there's a lot of them. We have the coat hanger, Colander 399, right here. For the longest time, it was an open cluster, but guess what? It is not an open cluster. The Hipparchos satellite did a lot of measuring of stellar distances. So there's a survey where they cataloged stars as to what type of star they were and how far they were from us. So even though this looks like a wonderful open cluster, and you're like, wow, that's cool, that's great, you know, God made it look like a coat hanger. It's actually just an asterism. Because the nearest star to us is at approximately 237 light years. So approximately 240 light years. The furthest one that makes up these brightest ones is 2,230 some odd light years away. So it is not an open cluster because the distances between the stars are just so far that all we're looking at is we're looking at a star that's here, a star that's here, a star that's here, and a star that's here, and it looks like an open cluster, but it's actually an illusion, pretty much. It is a beautiful object. I've seen it out at almost Evans Star Party, visually, no telescope, no binoculars. I've actually seen it out by Culpeper. I had a friend that lived way out north of Culpeper, an area called Eggbornsville, if you've ever heard of that. Really dark skies. I mean, you were actually able to see the coat hanger naked eye. Another one that is really cool because it almost borders on being a globular cluster is NGC 7789 in Cassiopeia, which is right here. Now, when I had my Pronto, it would look like a globular cluster. It was almost a perfect circle, a fuzzy, perfect round circle. As I worked my way up in aperture in my refractors, because I eventually purchased an older Teleview SDF 101, you began resolving the stars within it. It's really cool to go from a fuzzy ball to all of a sudden this explosion of stars, beautiful stars right there. Currently I have a Teleview 85 and it's a wonderful view. Crank up the power in a bigger scope, it's even a more wonderful view. But this is one of the objects that is borderline between, some astronomers say it's a globular that really didn't become a globular, and some astronomers say it's an open cluster that is just very compact, very rich, and very filled up with stars. There's another view of it. It's an absolutely wonderful. It's also known as Caroline's cluster because William Herschel's sister is the one that first observed this object. Beautiful. And of course, it's in Cassiopeia, so you're along what? The galactic plane, so you have tons and more objects to observe. So now we're going to start into globular clusters. Globulars are, of course, a spherical, that's where the globular term comes from, a spherical collection of stars. They're very tightly bound by gravity, and they're found mainly in the halo of our galaxy and other galaxies. Because you can actually see some of the globular clusters that exist in the Andromeda galaxy. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a little bit when I talk about some of the observing resources you have for observing both of these different types of objects. There's 152 of them. in the Milky Way. There's what's called the Shapley Sawyer concentration class. It almost sounds like a type of ship out of Star Trek. It's based on the concentration, and it has Roman numerals from 1 to 12. Well, let's go into a few here. So, we have M75, and it's considered a class 1. It's nice and beautiful and dispersed. You have M3, which is 6. It's a little more concentrated. And M55, look at that. Absolutely amazing. And some of these stars, you can see, have our reds and yellows. It's phenomenal. It's beautiful looking at them. Prime examples of globular clusters. One of the favorites in the night sky, even one of mine, is M13. One of the objects that, drum roll please, you can actually see naked eye out it. You can see it at most of our dark sky locations, but it's really cool to see it out at TMI. It's wonderful to see it out there. M15 Pegasus is another wonderful one. A few weeks ago, out at the Observatory Park, I was out there with Alan doing one of the introductions to Observatory Park, and we were looking at M15 through the astrophysics 180mm. Wonderful view. Fantastic, beautiful view. The stars are exploding. And M5 and Serpents is another wonderful one. Now, a few stories about M13. In a smaller telescope, like a Pronto, which is 70 millimeters, or even the Teleview 85, it's a fuzzball. It's a beautiful, perfectly concentrically round fuzzball. You throw more aperture on it, more and more is visible. I've seen it through a 12-inch, I forgot what they called them, the ones that was the ball mount. Portable. We had a member, Harold Bybee. He used to be a member. He had a 12-inch and a portable, and that looked phenomenal because he would put in a nice wide field eyepiece. It was great. And he would just crank up the power, looking at it about 100-time magnification, and a 12-inch was wonderful. Also, I've had a chance to look at it through Pete's God, giant optical device. It explodes because M13, they are estimating, their estimates, that there are approximately 500,000 stars in M13. And it shows as you crank up the power, it just more and more, and it's a beautiful, wonderful, wonderful scene. So you have, of course, what we're calling extragalactic globulars. You have M55 in Sagittarius that is considered outside of our galaxy. It's just kind of wandering around out there on its own. Andromeda G1. This is an actual globular cluster in the Andromeda galaxy. Had a chance to see that through a 12-inch. It's actually visible in a nice 12-inch reflector at a relatively dark sky site. When you have Andromeda pretty much straight overhead, you're able to actually see G1. How do we observe it? Some of the best resources for observing are the Astronomical League, various Astronomical League observing clubs. The Astronomical League has an open cluster club. You observe 100, there's 125 stars listed, open clusters. They're not that really difficult to observe. They're relatively easy to observe because you really don't need a large telescope to observe. Then they have a globular cluster club. This is the manual that you get from the Astronomical League. It's absolutely great. It has details on every single one of the globulars you're going to take a look at. And you observe, you observe 50 of the globular clusters. and there's 137 of them. And then there's what they call the challenge list. And the challenge list has on it G1, which we just took a look at. It's an Andromeda. There's a few others, and one of them is called NGC 5053. It's actually visible. They're calling it a challenge object because even though it's readily visible, you have to really have a lot more power and you have to crank up your aperture in order to see the detail, because when you first look at it in a telescope, it looks like a star that's been kind of bunched together and it just kind of looks irregular. But as you go up in aperture and you go up in power, you're actually able to resolve a little more and a little more of it. The astronomical, the observing clubs are great. You can observe the open and the globulars via their Messier observing clubs. Their binocular one is wonderful for open. Even the normal Messier list that they have, or Messier club. The NGC list that they have. And then there's a wonderful book called Star Clusters by Brent Archinal, one of the original NOVAC members. He actually lives out in Flagstaff. He's a scientist with the Naval Observatory out in Flagstaff. And it is a wonderful, it's a great book. Now, some of the other lists that the Astronomical League has, for those of you that are beginners, just starting out, the Urban Observing List is great. It has a lot of the open clusters in it. But not any of the binocular lists have some great objects in there. And then, of course, the actual individual specific open and globular clubs are a great resource. How do we observe? Equipment. So we'll start off with open clusters. One of your best basic tools for open clusters is a nice pair of binoculars. A nice pair of binoculars will get you started on an open cluster list right out of the gate. A very good open cluster, it's great for open clusters, it's good for globulars. It's for the brighter ones and the bigger ones, they're good, but you need a little bit more. A nice rich field telescope, like a wide field telescope, like a Teleview 85, one of the others that are in the 70 to 80 millimeter range that give you a nice 3-degree view are wonderful tools for open clusters, and they're pretty good with globulars because you can swap out your eyepieces and crank up the power for some of the globulars to get some of the detail from the brighter, larger globulars. Larger telescopes are okay. They're good for open clusters. They're more okay for open clusters. When I was out at Observatory Park, we put a nice eyepiece into the astrophysics, and we were taking a look at the Pleiades. You're only able to get about half of them in there, half of the Pleiades in. And for my taste, how I feel, you need a nicer, bigger view in order to capture the beauty and the grandeur of it. So that was a little bit too narrow a view for open clusters, but for globulars, when you're at that 7-inch, 8-inch, 10-inch telescope range, globulars start to really open up and they become wonderful objects. Globulars are pretty much almost like galaxies. The more aperture you have, the more you're able to see. It's kind of the reverse with open. The bigger your telescope, the less of the open cluster you're going to see. So it's kind of a give and take. It all depends on what your observing environment is. It depends on your budget. If you can afford a nice pair of binoculars, 9x56s, or I guess the standard now, and you're able to observe open clusters nonstop, have at it, enjoy it. The whole focus for my presentation is to get everyone in here to log on to their computer, if you have to log on, go to the astronomical lead, even if you don't have a telescope, open up the urban observing list, and discover what is there for you to see. If you have a telescope, start digging up the list. Make, you know, pledge to yourself you're going to look at one a week. One a week, and you'll be pleased by what you're seeing once a week. If you can observe more, have at it. They're wonderful objects for you to observe. And that's what I have for you tonight. Go to the AO list. Go out and observe. Even do some naked eye observing. Go out and look at Colander 70, the Belt of Orion. Put it down that you looked at it. Find the Big Dipper. Look at it. Get your binoculars out. Look at it. Go out and enjoy. They're beautiful objects. They're very aesthetically pleasing. They're not as difficult as... I mean, galaxies can be very beautiful, but you need a lot more horsepower for galaxies than you do these objects. So, enjoy and have a safe drive.